Good afternoon, everybody. This is the 2023 General Budget Conference Committee, Joint Budget Conference Committee on Public Protection, Criminal Justice, and Judiciary. I am Assemblyman Jeffrey Dinowitz. I'm chairman of the Assembly Codes Committee and co-chair of this conference committee, along with my colleague to my right, your left, State Senator Jamal Bailey. And I would like to introduce the following Assembly members: Assembly Judiciary Chair Charles Levine, Assembly Corrections Chair Eric DeLon, Assembly Governmental Operations Chair John McDonald, along with Assembly members Monique Chandler Waterman, Phil Palmisano, and Marjorie Burns.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm State Senator Jamal Bailey, and as you can see, all things run through the borough of the Bronx. I am the chair of the Codes Committee and the co-chair of the General Conference Public Protection Committee, Criminal Justice and Judiciary Subcommittee, and I would like to introduce the following members of the State Senate. To my right, State Senator Brad Holman Siegel, the chair of the Judiciary Committee, Senator Kevin Thomas, chair of the Consumer Protection Committee, Senator Anthony Palumbo, the ranking member of the Codes Committee and the ranking member of the Judiciary Committee, and Senator Julia Salazar, the chair of the Corrections Committee, is en route from session at present time. Senator Thomas O'Mara and Senator Shelley Mayer are also alternates to this panel. They are both, again, in session as the Senate is still going on. Assemblyman Dinowitz. Excuse me. Pursuant to the public offices law, the Senate has appointed Giovanni Lopicolo as recording secretary to keep minutes and to publish the activities of the conference committee at the end of this process.
And I would like to introduce Laszlo Gendler as the recording secretary for the Assembly to keep minutes and to publish the activities of the conference committee at the end of this process. And I would also like to give one of our colleagues, Assemblymember Palmisano, a minute or under to say a few words.
Do you want me to go now?
Yes, and your minute already started.
Can you hear me all right? Well, I'll just thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate your patience as always. Obviously, the Assembly minority is really disappointed that your One House budget failed to address the issue of crime and not addressing bail reform in the One House budget. We remain concerned that the policies you're focused on are not working to ensure public safety in our communities, protecting and providing justice to crime victims, and providing tools and resources for our law enforcement on the streets and inside our correctional facilities to protect them and the communities they serve, whether it's eliminating cash bail, raising the age, or discovery laws. We're fearful this is creating a dangerous environment in our communities, creating more dangerous and violent crime, making New Yorkers less safe, and they want action. And the number one responsibility of government is to keep their citizens safe, and New York's not doing that. It doesn't make any sense that New York is the only state in the union that does not provide judges judicial discretion to deal with the dangerousness of an individual. We have a staffing crisis in our correctional facilities, Mr. Chair. Even at the budget hearing, the corrections chair said that there's 867 vacancies in corrections officers, 1,000 by the end of the year. We need better pay, better benefits, more classes, more staff, more recruits. We should allow 19-year-olds to become a corrections officer. If we allow them to serve our nation, to protect us, our freedoms, and risk their lives there, they should be able to be a corrections officer if they want to choose that professional. We need more staff. They're burnt out, and morale is down. They're mandated overtime. It's an unsafe environment for them, an unsafe environment for the incarcerated individuals who serve there. On a safety issue, since the passage of HALT, which limits restriction and use of segregated confinement to segregate the most dangerous and violent incarcerated individuals from the general population to keep them safe, we've seen a dramatic spike since April, a 24% increase in inmate on staff assaults, a 36% increase on inmate on inmate assaults, a record high number of assaults ending year 2022 with 300 plus more to a 1,400 incidents in the past year. This needs to be addressed. After a recent tour of Rikers, I mean, just stabbings alone, we've seen an increase from 2020 from 129 to 491. We need to provide more tools and resources to our staff to invest in it, not just for our staffing and our facilities. We need drug dogs at each correctional facility. Mm-hmm. We need to approve the use of body scanner technology inside our correctional facilities. We know drug use and contraband getting in our facilities is rising, and that leads to violence, it leads to more gang activity. We need to act now, sooner rather than later, if we want to ensure safety and security inside our correctional facilities. And on the issue of violence, on that visit to Rikers, there was more than 40% of the staff there are female. And there's been a rise of sexual assaults on corrections officer female staff, 40-plus in the last couple of years. And interestingly enough, I'm not sure if everyone on this panel knows that sexual assault against a corrections officer is a misdemeanor in the state. It should be a felony. We should address that soon. If we can't address it in the budget, we should be passing Assembly Bill 1606, Senate Bill 5506 to protect our corrections officers and make sure any sexual assault to get them is a felony, not a misdemeanor.
Thank you, Mr. Palmisano.
Thank you, Assemblymember Dinowitz. Before I see if any of my colleagues want to say some words, that again, but if you mention here, this does cut into your debate time on the floor during the Senate. I just want to let you know that if you're doing it, I'm going to subtract it from your debate time. But I really wanted to seriously acknowledge the important work that the finance and council staff of the state Senate does. Lakia Martin, Dorothy Powell, Donovan Borrington, Adriel Douglas, Yasmin Bailey, Stephen Coach, Janine Smith, Giovanni Lopicola, and Amelia Sacco, thank you for what you've done now and in advance for what you will be doing during these next couple of weeks. We appreciate the work that you do and that you will do. So do any of my colleagues have brief remarks that they'd like to make? Senator Hoyman-Siegel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, Mr. Co-Chair, and the other co-chair, Assemblymember Dinowitz and Senator Bailey. I just wanted to mention a few judiciary highlights in the Senate One House budget. We urge a $10 million increase over the executive and funding for the Indigent Legal Services Family Representation Program for a total of $14.5 million. We know that the need is much higher, $28 million, so we encourage the executive and the assembly to contribute money as well. If we don't fully fund family representation, the state risks a costly lawsuit to force it into compliance with constitutional requirements to provide parental representation. Secondly, there's $19 million in our One House for a pilot program to keep family courts in New York City open until midnight on at least one day a week. This proposal is gonna help working parents make court appearances on a schedule that makes sense for them. I'm gonna also continue pushing for an increase in the number of family court judges statewide pursuant to the recommendations of the Williams Commission, which works to end racial injustice in our court system. The Senate includes our legislation S-160, which will finally and permanently implement audio-visual coverage of court proceedings in New York. The court system already has most of the technology it needs due to the vital proceedings that were launched during the pandemic, so this change is really a no-brainer. The Senate also advances language requiring additional transparency from the unified court system about judicial training, performance, and security. My colleagues and I were not satisfied, to put it mildly, with the answers provided by the Office of Court Administration at our public protection budget hearing. We need to know that judges are attending the classes that taxpayers pay for and that the training is effective. We also deserve to know how and why millions of taxpayer dollars are being spent on questionable security details for certain judicial officers. The Senate restores funding for civil legal services, which is crucial. And finally, while both houses increased pay and funding for 18B panel attorneys, thank you, Senator Bailey, including panel attorneys for the children, both houses failed to include increased funding for other attorney for the children providers. I urge my colleagues to support $15 million for attorney for the children provider organizations in the final budget agreement. Thank you, Mr. Co-Chair.
Thank you, Senator Hoyman. We have been joined by Senator Shelley May, the chair of the Education Committee, one of the best presiding officers the Senate has ever seen. Do we have any other comments? Senator Palumbo.
Thank you, Chairman. And here it is on. Okay. I just wanted to indicate, and not be too repetitive, but I do concur with comments made by my Assembly colleague, Phil Palmisano, and that the Senate Republican Conference has consistently called for various reforms to the criminal justice policies that have been added, including removing the least restrictive means aspect. And we further support and hope that the budget will not include any other proposals that threaten public safety, in our opinion, such as the Clean Slate Act, elder parole, sentencing reform. We hope that action will be taken in the budget to address violent crime, supporting crime victims, and further investing in law enforcement, including creating the Safer Communities Grant Program to invest in critical investigatory and prosecutorial resources designed to increase case clearance rates for homicides and gun crimes, increasing funding for gun interdiction efforts, raising the caps on Office of Victim Services reimbursements for crime victims, and investing in victim support programs. Now, we do support several provisions currently included in the executive budget for fiscal year 2024, the addition of two new state police academies, continuing the $40 million appropriation to the Criminal Justice Discovery Compensation Fund, the $40 million appropriation for grants to DA's offices insisting with discovery compliance, the additional $40 million for DA's offices to hire new prosecutors to deal with these reforms, $7 million in new funding for an anti-fentanyl innovation grant, which would be used to create specialized units targeting illegal fentanyl distribution, and the $7.4 million for increased staffing for an enhanced parole supervision program within DOCS. It's a supervision against violent engagement. And just lastly, regarding the rate increases, I'm glad that we've done this, and Chairman Bailey, I know you've been working hard for that, to get that to come to fruition. And of course, the hourly rate assigned counsel program hasn't had a raise in 20 years. So the Senate Republican Conference believes that that's way too long for such an increase, that it's well overdue. I guess the fact that it's continued, the counties would be mandated to fund all of this pay raise without state assistance. That would take effect on April 1st, 2023. The impact of this pay raise would vary between regions and counties, but of course would result in a high unfunded mandate fiscal impact for county budgets. So in that regard, I support it. And I believe we support it fully for indigent counsel and assigned counsel, but we would like to see some state aid on that. But thank you for giving me an opportunity to comment.
Thank you, Senator. We have also again been joined by Senator Julio Salazar, the chair of the Crime Victims, Crime and Corrections Committee in the Senate. Assemblymember Dinowitz.
Okay. The following agencies will be discussed at this Public Protection Joint Conference Committee, and they include the Division of Criminal Justice Services, Judiciary, the Office of Indigent Legal Services, Interest on Lawyers Account, Department of Corrections and Community Supervision, Department of Law, Division of State Police, Division of Homeland Security and Emergency Services, Division of Military and Naval Affairs, Office of Victim Services, Office for the Prevention of Domestic Violence, Commission of Prosecutorial Conduct, Commission on Judicial Conduct, Commission on Judicial Nomination, Judicial Screening Committee, State Commission on Correction.
The table has come to an agreement on the appropriations for the following agencies: the Division of State Police, the Division of Military and Naval Affairs, the State Commission of Correction, the Commission on Prosecutorial Conduct, the Commission on Judicial Conduct, the Commission on Judicial Nomination, the Judicial Screening Commission, and the Interest on Lawyer Account.
Both houses have accepted the following executive Article 7 proposals in the budget: criminal justice extenders, that's in PPGG Part A, and hazard mitigation revolving loan funds in PPGG Part G.
The following Article 7 proposals do not have a three-way agreement: proposed amendments to bail reform, PPGG Part B; body scanners in docks and OCFS facilities, PPGG Part C; lowering the hiring age of correction officers to 19-year-olds, PPGG Part D; the criminal repository, PPGG Part E; concealed carry technical amendments, PPGG Part F; the firefighter training stipend, PPGG Part H; modernizing domestic violence policy, PPGG Part I; expanding eligibility for World Trade Center death and disability benefits to New York's organized militia, PPGG Part J; 18B assigned counsel rates, PPGG Part P; and market-based interest rates on court judgments, PPGG Part U.
Issues that will need to be addressed at this conference subcommittee include gun violence prevention programs funding, that includes Operation Snug and Project Give, parental representation funding, hourly rate increases for 18B assigned counsel and the Attorney for Child program, defender services and prosecutorial services funding, pretrial services funding, discovery funding, voice communication services in DOCS facilities, Victims of Crime Act grants funding, and volunteer firefighters funding.
So we have an outlook in the Senate majority, and we look forward to resolving and restoring vital criminal justice funding, increasing funding for gun violence prevention programs, providing state funding to support pay increases for assigned counsel, discovery, pretrial services, alternatives to incarceration programs, the inclusion of a clean slate, addressing civil and criminal legal services issues, extended operations for family court and services for incarcerated individuals suffering from a mental illness. And if I may, I just as we've heard it during the One House, and I'm positive that we'll hear it during the conversation during the enacted budget, this majority does not believe that public safety is a monolithic issue that can be encapsulated with two words, bail reform. I would like to remind everybody about what bail reform is and what it's not. The purpose of bail, constitutionally, is to ensure that individuals return to court. This is a pretrial distinction, meaning that the presumption of innocence is with the individual that is charged. Let us all remember that concept as we bandy about the conversation of public safety and bail reform, as we continue this march towards April 1st, most importantly, this march in our respective districts, communities throughout the great state of New York. Let us be reminded that we all want to make sure that our constituents are safe. We can have plenty of discussions and conversations about what we believe the best way is, but let us not be too resolved. Let us not be too caught up on two words. Assemblyman Dinowitz.
So I think we share many of the same goals. In the Assembly, we look forward to working with the Senate and the governor to provide critical funding to enhance public protection in New York. We hope to enact legislation providing 18B assigned counsel pay at a rate of $164 per hour statewide, toll-free calls and correction facilities, pretrial services funding, victim services funding, and increased funding for gun violence prevention programs, defender and prosecutorial services, discovery, facility upgrades at volunteer firefighters facilities, deed theft intervention programs, World Trade Center death and disability benefits for members of the New York State Organized Militia, as well as various policy proposals that would create a safer New York. And I would just say, in closing, when my constituents talk to me, they do talk about public safety. They do want safe streets. They don't usually refer anymore to those two words, but they're talking about the need for public safety. And I think that's what all of us here, regardless of house or affiliation, agree upon, and that's what we're gonna work towards in the next 2 weeks or week and a half. Thank you.
This.
And we have a closing.
Chair Levine.
Thank you. Just very, very briefly, I want to take an opportunity to thank the extraordinary staff of the New York State Assembly who have worked so hard and will continue to work hard to guarantee that we have a good budget. And I also want to say that as someone who lives in Nassau County, which is one of the safest counties in the entire United States of America, as is New York City, as the safest big city in the United States of America, that we are still acutely aware that there is a public perception that public safety must be addressed. And I think one of the steps that we are taking in this joint conference committee is to make sure that there is sufficient financial support for our judiciary and for our attorney general. And we are also going to support those who work in the courts, both prosecutors and defense counsel. A rate increase for defense counsel is certainly long overdue, and I'm hopeful that we're going to address that and address that in such a way that the counties will be satisfied. And I hope we're also going to be able to agree on enhanced funding for discovery, both for our prosecutors and for our defense counsel in our courts, because after all, it's in our courts where justice is administered, and it is in our nature as Americans to believe in justice. Thank you.
With nothing further, I believe that means we stand adjourned. Thank you all for coming, and happy budget.
You're right.
Happy budget.